Pathology, that is the pathology of vulva, vagina, and cervix. So we all know that carcinoma cervix is the second most common malignancy in India and is one of the most leading causes of death all over the world, especially in the developing countries. So we are going to deal with all of it in detail. First, a quick, I'll just quickly go through vulva and vagina since we are already late. My internet was all hanging and the computer didn't work. And so we joined in a little late. So let's just rush through vulva and vaginal pathology. So the commonest cyst that we come across in vulva is the Bartholin cyst, which is caused by the blockage of the duct by any sort of infection. So whenever there's a duct blockage, that is how the Bartholin cyst is caused. So whenever the duct gets blocked, the secretion gets pent up, and it becomes a very very fertile ground for infections to pool in. So this can lead to abscess formation. A Bartholin cyst can be lined by transitional epithelium, or it can also be lined by squamous epithelium. Now, vulva also has its own set of malignancies. The commonest one is the vulval carcinoma, and there is a very prominent intraepithelial lesion in the vulva, which is known as the VIN, known as the vulval intraepithelial neoplasia. Now, this again is caused by high-risk HPV 16 and 18. What VIN 1, 2, and 3 would mean? The logic is same as the CIN or the cervical carcinoma in situ, intraepithelial neoplasia. So how VIN 1, 2, and 3 are stratified, I'm going to deal in detail in cervical intraepithelial neoplasia. So the way is same over here in vulva itself. So it progresses to squamous cell carcinoma of the vulval region. 3% of all genital carcinoma is the vulval carcinoma. It affects older women, and the growth could be exophytic, endophytic, or it could be infiltrative. Now, varicose carcinoma are also very well known in the vagina, in the vulval region. These are nothing but extremely well-differentiated squamous cell carcinoma presenting as the fungating masses. They are very well differentiated, so the pleomorphism is minimal. There is rare mitosis. It just invades as broad tongue-shaped fronts, and there is always a local invasion. We have read in detail about varicose carcinomas when we were studying head and neck malignancy or the oral squamous cell carcinoma. So the similar morphology is seen in varicose carcinoma of the vulva itself. Now the Paget's disease, it is seen in the epidermis of the vulva. Here we see large cells, pale vacuolated cytoplasm, and clear halo, which are present inside the epithelial or the epithelial lining of the epidermis. And these cells are false positive. That is known as the Paget's disease. The common sites are nipple, axilla, perianal region, and labia majora. We come to vagina. So the commonest malignancy here is the squamous cell carcinoma, which is seen in 60 to 70 years of age, and it presents as an exophytic mass usually. And the other one, which is seen in less than 5 years of age, is the type of a rhabdomyosarcoma, or also known as the sarcoma botryoides, because it resembles a bunch of grapes. So these are spindle cell lesion, or the spindle cell malignancy, or a sarcoma, which are arising from the skeletal muscle cells. So this is the malignancies of rhabdomyoblasts. Now we come to cervix. Now cervix is the most common site of infection as well as malignant transformation. The part proximal to the external os is lined by tall columnar mucin-secreting cells, while the part distal to the external os is lined by the non-keratinizing squamous epithelium cells. So there are the two epitheliums which are coming in contact with each other at a point which is known as the transformation zone. So this portion, which is the endocervical canal, is lined by the columnar cells, while this portion, which is outside the transformation zone, this entire portion of the cervix is lined by the squamous epithelial cell or stratified squamous epithelial lining. So this particular zone, transformation zone, is a point of active mitosis, and is a part of active wear and tear, and that is why has got is liable to get infected, as well as there can be increased risk of malignant transformation in this transformation zone. We all know how cervix and vagina are divided anatomically. So we see an immature squamous cell line. Now, what is squamous metaplasia? Squamous meta, we can all see here. See, this is the columnar lining. Ideally, this photograph should be rotated. This should be above and this should be below. So this is the columnar lining, which is present in the endocervical region. I'm really sorry that this photograph is rotated in opposite manner. So this is the endocervical lining, while this is the stratified squamous lining. And this particular point is the actual point of transformation zone, where the endocervical lining and the ectocervical lining are meeting each other as a transformation zone. Now, transformation zone, due to active wear and tear, can undergo squamous metaplasia. So squamous metaplasia is nothing but presence of immature squamous cells in the at the places where we are expecting a columnar lining. For example, the basically what we say is the shifting of the transformational zone as and when there is active wear and tear. Whenever there is commencement of sexual activity, what happens is this endocervical epithelial cells, they start undergoing metaplasia and they start acquiring squamous morphology. So initially there is an immature metaplasia, later leading on to a mature metaplasia. So the columnar epithelium undergoes squamous metaplasia near the external os. The junction between the squamous and the columnar cells now shift towards the internal os. Okay, so the area between the previous squamocolumnar junction and new squamocolumnar junction is known as the transformation zone. Now we come on to the lesions of cervix. The commonest one is the endocervical polyp. These are the benign exophytic growths. They are present predominantly in the endocervical canal. They can be small, sessile, looks like a bump, or there can be large polypoidal masses of endocervical cells. The stroma inside is loose fibromyxoid. Now, what is a polyp? Anybody? Can anybody tell me what is a polyp? Now, are my slides moving? Are you able to see my slides? Are you able to see the slides moving now? Okay, great. So polyp, see, how do we define a polyp scientifically is that it is any part of the tissue which is lined by the columnar cells, which is lined by the epithelium at least three points. That is known as, or at least at three sites, that is known as a polyp. So the polyp is having a peduncle. Whenever it is a pedunculated polyp or a stalk that we call it, and the epithelium lined on three sides, while it is attached to the epithelium and one side. So one side is raw, from where the excision takes place, and it has got a stalk, or it might not even have a stalk for that matter if it is a sessile polyp, and is lined by the epithelium out at three sides of the tissue. Understood, everyone? So that is a polyp. So this polyp lined by the epithelium on three sides has got fibromyxoid stroma and is covered by mucin secreting endocervical cells. Now, due to active wear and tear, even this can undergo inflammation and can get infected from time and again. So this may lead to episodes of recurrent cervicitis. Now, what is cervicitis? It is extremely common. It is due to constant exposure to the vaginal flora, and the infected organisms are Streptococcus, herpes simplex, Staphylococcus, Enterococcus, Chlamydia, E. coli, Mycoplasma. So changing of pH is a very important factor in cervicitis. So what is the normal pH and what in the cervix is responsible for maintaining that pH? Anybody? What is the normal pH of the cervix? Yes, it is acidic pH. So, yes, very good. So, lactobacilli are the bacteria which are responsible for maintaining this particular pH, and the pH remains anywhere between 4.5. So, it is slightly acidic. Now, whenever there is disbalance of the pH, that is the time the other bacterial organisms, they find nidus or focus here and starts proliferating, causing cervicitis. Now, acute cervicitis happens when the cervix is erythematous, swollen, there is pus discharge, acute inflammation, while chronic cervicitis, usually chronic inflammation, non-specific inflammation is there, there is erythema with erosions, and HPV and herpes simplex virus can be seen. Now, a classical cell type seen in HPV, human papillomavirus, is coelocytic change that we will be discussing in detail later. And herpes simplex virus can be noted by presence of the prominent intranuclear inclusions under the microscope. Now, due to chronic cervicitis, there can be squamous metaplasia. There can be formation of Nabothian cysts. There can be squamous carcinoma, erosion, ulceration. So, cervical neoplasia, we come to the cervical malignancy now. So, worldwide cervical cancer is the fourth most frequent cancer in women, with an estimated of these many cases per year, which is attributed to 7.5% of all female cancer deaths. In India, cervical cancer contributes to approximately 6 to 29% of all cancers in women. And it is the second most common cancer in women aged between 15 to 44 years in India. So, according to ICMR data, the incidence of cervical carcinoma in India is around 20 to 35 per 100,000 women between age 35 to 64, and which is very high in comparison to other developed countries. So, the risk of carcinoma cervix is higher in this part of the world. Now, etiopathogenesis, we all know human papilloma virus leads to carcinoma cervix, but HPV is a very common infection at the time after the commencement of sexual intercourse. So HPV infection, if it is so common, why carcinoma cervix is not so common is because there are other etiological factors which lead to the actual carcinogenesis or actual malignancy. So, HPV will remain as the most important etiological factor, followed by early age of intercourse, multiple sexual partners, cigarette smoking, multiparity, lack of circumcision in male, and oral contraceptive use. Now, we come to human papillomavirus. Have you all understood till now? Are things clear till now? We go to human papillomavirus. Now, 76 types of HPVs are known. It is divided into a low-risk HPV and a high-risk HPV. Low-risk HPV, HPV 6 and 11, while high-risk HPV, HPV 16 and 18. It is transmitted through sexual intercourse and it infects the epithelium in the transformation zone. So, any epithelium which is actively dividing will be more susceptible to infections. So, HPV infection again will happen in the transformation zone, and epithelium gets transformed to a pre-malignant or a pre-neoplastic epithelium. So, we are going to tell you what these epithelial changes would be. Now, how does HPV lead to malignancy? The oncogenic types of HPV encode two viral oncoproteins, E6 and E7, that bind to retinoblastoma and P53 respectively. So, E6 binds to retinoblastoma while E7 binds to P53. So, they have, whenever it's a high risk type of HPV, they have a very high affinity to bind and to neutralize their function. which inhibit cyclins. Now, hypophosphorylated form of retinoblastoma is the activated form of retinoblastoma. So, this when binds to this retinoblastoma, when it's hypophosphorylated, will bind to the E2F or the elongation factor and is going to block the synthetic phase or the transcriptional block happens. And that is how whenever there is any genomic defects, the retinoblastoma blocks the defect or stops any sort of transcription. Now, what is hyperphosphorylated? Now, certain growth factors like epidermal growth factors, PDGF and all, these they activate the cyclins. Now, this activation of cyclin leads to formation of hyperphosphorylated form of retinoblastoma. Now this becomes inactive. Once it is inactivated, the elongation factor is thrown free to bind to the DNA, and therefore it progresses to S phase and activates S phase, leading to transcription. Have you all understood the role of retinoblastoma? Now, what are the proteins E6 and E7 doing here? E7 is binding to this retinoblastoma. So it inhibits the E2F retinoblastoma complex, therefore leading to immortalization and increased cell proliferation. At the same time, E6 is binding to TERT. Therefore, it increases telomerase expression, it inhibits P53, and all of it is leading to increased cell proliferation. Understood, everyone? Yes, that is how HPV is working. So, HPV has got two important factors, the E6 and the E7. E6 binds to P53, while E7 binds to retinoblastoma. Now, both of them are genes. So binding to them is going to lead to the neoplastic transformation of the cell. To put it simply, however, the actual effector mechanism I have explained you just now. Please, can you tell me, is this clear to you? The role of E6 and E7? Yes. I'm not getting any replies. If it's not clear, you please let me know. I'll repeat it once again. Can you all hear me? Am I audible? Okay, I'm audible. So can you please tell me, has everyone understood? Okay. Now the other very important factor is cigarette smoking. So cigarette smoking is carcinogenic because it has got polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, which lead to DNA adduct formation. Now HPV infection leads to subcellular changes that we just read. Now, what are the cellular changes or what do we see under the microscope? So what we see under the microscope when a particular keratinocyte or the squamous cell is infected with HPV is presence of a coelocyte. So coelocyte, when we see under the microscope, is nothing but a very big hint towards presence of HPV infection. Now, coelocytes are epithelial cells containing hyperchromatic nucleus that is eccentrically displaced by a perinuclear vacuole. So there is this prominent vacuole. This is the entire cell. This is the cell boundary. This is the real color of the cytoplasm. And if we see a perinuclear halo or a perinuclear clearing, that is known as, this particular cell is known as a coelocyte. There are important nuclear features like there should be hyperchromasia or nuclear irregularity must be present to be classified it into a coelocyte. So nuclear changes as well as cytoplasmic changes together make a coelocyte. Now, these are used by pathologists to help identify HPV-infected epithelial cells in Pap smear. Now, what are Pap smears? How do we attain this microscopy? I'll be telling you right now. But initially, I wanted to tell you what a coelocyte is. Now, coelocyte is the cell which is not just seen in a Pap smear. It can also be seen in a biopsy. Make this clear. It's just that they're more prominently and beautifully seen in a Pap smear. Now, what is cervical intraepithelial neoplasia? CIN is a spectrum of dysplasia which are confined within the epithelium that begins at the basal layers and progressively involves other layers to form carcinoma in situ. Now, CIN is classified into CIN 1, 2, and 3, depending upon the thickness of involvement. Now, what do you understand by thickness of involvement? Basically, these are the cell layers in the epidermis that are involved. So, what are the specific changes that we are supposed to look into the epidermis to classify it into a neoplastic epidermis? Is by increased nucleus size, hyperchromasia, increased mitotic activity, increased nuclear cytoplasmic ratio, and more severe to increasing rates of CIN and carcinomatous change. Now, what is CIN1? When the basal one-third of the epithelium is included, which means there is high NC ratio, nuclear hyperchromasia, there is active mitosis, there is disorganized cell growth, there is nuclear pleomorphism at the lower one-third of the epidermis only. So, only lower one-third of the epidermis is involved. CIN2, we see similar changes when the lower two-third is involved. And CIN3, when the more than two-third is involved. Now, carcinoma in situ is when the entire thickness is involved. So, there is a difference between CIN3 and carcinoma situ. We should not be using these two terms synonymously. Carcinoma in situ is complete thickness, while CIN3 is more than two-thirds. Okay? So, when it becomes more than two-thirds CIN3 and when it becomes full thickness, it is carcinoma in situ. Now, this is what I was talking about. This is exfoliative cytology. Now, this is Pap smear, while this one is biopsy. You should know at least by photomicrographs that how these two look differently. Here, we are just taking out and reading the cells. We just scrape the cervix with the help of an IR spatula and we smear it onto a slide, and this is how we make Pap smear. While this one is when the entire chunk of tissue is removed. This is a biopsy, this is a Pap smear. Now, these are the various grades of neoplastic changes which I had just described here when we were talking about atypia in the cervical lining. So, all these are the levels of atypia. CIN 1, 2, and 3 will correspond to. Now, mild dysplasia is CIN 1, which is the low-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion. Now, squamous intraepithelial lesion or SIL is the term that we use in Pap smears, while CIN is the term that we use in the biopsy. Okay, so these two are different, and this is the connotation if you get a report of CIN 1. So, if we get a report on a biopsy of CIN1, we mean it is mild dysplasia. If we get a report of LSIL or the low-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion on a cervical Pap smear, this means it is mild dysplasia. At the same time, CIN2, 3 usually and carcinoma in situ correlate with HSIL or the high-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion on Pap smear. So, this one is Pap smear. This is through biopsy, and this is what it actually denotes.
Now, we all know that the highest viral loads are found in maturing keratinocytes in the upper half of the epithelium. So what is actually happening is that HPV E6 and E7 proteins, they prevent cell cycle arrest. So cells in the upper portion of the epithelium express certain markers of actively dividing cells, such as Ki67. Now, Ki67 ideally is supposed to be expressed by the basal layers. But if the superficial layers start expressing Ki67, at the same time, P16, which is a cyclin-dependent kinase inhibitor, so both of them staining together is a very important diagnostic clue to HPV infection. So whenever HPV infection is present, we do an immunohistochemical stain of Ki67 and P16 co-expression, which is expressed by the superficial layers. And therefore, is a very good stain when we use it in pap smear. It is used for confirmation of diagnosis in equivocal cases of SIS. Now, what is the risk of progression? L-cell regresses in 60% of the cases. L-cell is actually nothing but expression of HPV presence. So if there is an L-cell lesion and we start seeing a lot of poilocytes in the smear, we should be sure that this lesion is going to regress on itself in 60% of the cases, while it will persist in 30% of the cases and become chronic, out of which only 10% will progress to HCC or high-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion. While if on biopsy or on pap smear, it's on pap smear that we detect HCC, if we detect HCC on pap smear, we are sure that 30% of the lesions will regress on its own without requiring any intervention. 60% will persist. So this is a dangerous lesion. This should be further biopsied, since 10% of these will progress to carcinoma. Have you all understood this? The difference between SILs and CIN, and what is the relevance of SIL and CIN? Now, how do we screen? The most important way of screening is exfoliative cytology, which is done by pap smears. Now, there are two ways in which we collect pap smear. It could be a conventional smear or it could be a liquid-based cytology smear. Now, that will be dealt with you in detail in your evening classes. Dr. Manisha is going to take up the difference between the liquid-based cytology and the conventional cervical smear or the conventional smear. And a very important way of screening these days is also HPV testing or the hybrid capture tool. Now, this is the IR spatula. We should all remember how an IR spatula looks like. And this is how it is shaped. This portion is actually the portion where we are holding it. And this portion is the one which is going inside the cervix and the vagina. So this portion goes inside the vagina into the cervix. And this is the portion where we are holding it. So we hinge at one point and rotate 360 degrees. This point is used for hinging, the shallow point, and the deeper point, it goes inside and we rotate it along the walls of the cervix. And whatever material is collected on this particular arm is smeared onto a slide. So this is how a conventional cervical smear is collected. Now, this is another way of doing it. This is how I was telling. We dilate the cervix with the help of the cuspos. We insert the spatula, IR spatula. We hinge it at a point and then we rotate 360 degrees. Now, this is smeared onto a slide. While the other or a better way of doing it, which is the latest technology, is the liquid-based cytology. It is done with the help of the endocervical brush. So, entire brush is inserted inside. Can you all notice that this entire brush is inserted inside and around 5-6 movements of 360 degree rotation are given, and then the brush is taken out and it is then dipped into a solution. Now this solution is sent into the laboratory and is processed by a machine and smears are prepared. accordingly. Okay. So the practical aspects will be taken up by Dr. Manisha. Now, invasive carcinoma cervix has got a high incidence and age group predominantly is 50 to 54 years. Etiology, we all know, is multiparity, lack of circumcision. Now, how does it look like grossly? Fungating cauliflower-like growth, ulcerative lesion, or the infiltrative lesion. Microscopically, we have a squamous cell carcinoma, adenosquamous, or undifferentiated carcinoma. So we can have a large cell non-keratinizing, large cell keratinizing, and small cell non-keratinizing carcinoma. So this is how it looks like. So this is the uterine, this is the uterus, and this is the part of the uterine cervix. And this is an ulcerative growth, which is showing a lot of necrosis in this area. Another specimen of the uterus, it is being cut into half, and this is the part of cervix which is showing the growth. Now, this is the cervical pap smear, which is showing marked atypia. So it is showing these atypical nuclei, bizarre nuclear forms, and this is the microscopy, which is showing carcinoma cervix. Now, this is the well or moderately differentiated carcinoma cervix, which is also showing keratin pearls in between. So these are the islands of atypical squamous cells with presence of keratin pearls. So this is a characteristic of squamous cell carcinoma of cervix. Similarly, that one was a well-differentiated one. This could be moderately or poorly differentiated, where the mitosis is high and proper keratinization is not discernible or is not evident. Now, carcinoma cervix can spread by direct spread. It can go into urinary bladder, peritoneum, ureter, rectum, or vagina. Or it can spread through lymphatic. So the commonest ones are the paracervical lymph node obturated in the external ileum. Hematogenously, it can spread to liver, lungs, and bone. So the small cell non-keratinizing and the adenosquamous have got a poor prognosis. Now, staging, stage 0 is carcinoma in situ. Stage 1 is carcinoma confined to cervix. Stage 2 is carcinoma extends beyond the cervix, but not to the pelvic bone. Carcinoma involves the vagina, but not the lower. Stage 3 is carcinoma has extended to the pelvic wall. On rectal examination, there is no cancer-free space between the tumor and the pelvic wall. The tumor involves the lower third of. Now, stage 4 is carcinoma has extended beyond the true pelvis or has involved the mucosa of the bladder or rectum. This stage also includes cancers with metastatic dissemination. Understood, everyone? So, here we were talking about stage 0, stage 1. Stage 1 is further divided into 1A, 1A1, 1A2, and 1B. So, I expect each and every one of you to go home, read the staging in detail, and remember each and every word of the staging. So what we were dealing with earlier by calling CIN 1, 2, 3, mild, moderate, severe dysplasias, or well-differentiated, moderately or poorly differentiated was the grading of carcinoma cervix. This is the staging of carcinoma. Now, screening. Screening is a very important part of carcinoma cervix. So, I just told you that cervical pap smear is the most important way by which screening is done. So, what are the recommendations on screening? So, the first smear should be at age 21 years or within 3 years of onset of sexual activity. And thereafter, every 3 years. Understood, everyone? So, we started at the age of 21, or if the person is getting married much earlier, so within 3 years of onset of sexual activity, the first smear should be taken definitely. Now, after 30, women who have had normal cytology results in the first smear and are negative for HPV. So, we are doing a normal cytology as well as HPV testing. If both are negative, then the patient or the person may be screened every 5 years. Not before that, it is not needed. So every 5 years,
after 3 years of commencement of sexual activity, every 5 years we do a follow-up. If the pap smear is normal or if the HPV is negative by hybrid capture assay. Now, women with a normal cytology result, when the pap smear is normal, but there is positive for higher risk HPV, these patients should be screened with cervical cytology or with pap smear every 6 to 12 months. So are you understanding the exact way that which we screen? So anyone with a normal cytology and no HPV, we screen every 5 years. Anything with normal cytology but presence of high risk HPV on hybrid capture assay DNA, we do every 6 to 12 months. When the result of a pap test is abnormal, a colposcopic examination of cervix and vagina is performed to identify the lesion. The mucosa is examined with a magnifying glass following application of acetic acid. Now, this highlights the abnormal epithelium as white spots. These areas are known as the acetovite area. And these acetovite or the abnormal leaking areas are biopsied. Okay, understood, everyone? So if there is an acetovite area, that particular area is biopsied. This is done only if the pap smear is abnormal. Now we come to HPV vaccine. There are 3 vaccines which are approved by US FDA. All of them, they protect against the high risk HPV type 16 and 18. Now what is the difference between the 3 vaccines? The first one or the earliest one is the Cervarix. This protects only against 16 and 18, or the two, both types of, most important types of HPVs. Now, Gardasil, it prevents against 4 types of HPV, which means 16, 18, 6 and 11, which means that it is also preventing against a low-risk HPV. While Gardasil 9, which is the latest version, it protects against the 9 variants of HPV. Okay. Now, this vaccine is recommended for all girls and boys by the age of 11 to 12 years. And also in young men and women up to the age of 26 years. So, if your age is less than 26 years, you must go in for HPV vaccination. So, thank you so much. So this is the doubt session. Last 5-10 minutes we can dedicate to doubts. So if anyone has any doubts, you can please ask me. I'm waiting for your replies in the chat box. Please send your questions in the chat box. Okay, I'll explain the procedure of taking the pap smear with the help of IR spatula once again. So this is the magnified view of IR spatula. So this is the portion where we hold. This is the portion that goes inside the vagina. And this one hinges onto at one point. And this one, this portion is rotated 360 degrees. And whatever material that is collected onto the spatula is smeared onto a slide. However, the complete detail of and re-revision of this part will be taken up by Dr. Manisha. And it's a very important part in your exam. So why is the vaccine recommended up to 26 years of age and why not after that? It's a very important question that you asked. And I would love to explain this question is that by the age of 26 or up to 30 years, the transient infection with HPV has already happened. So So anyone who is more prone to transform into malignancy, the cellular changes would have happened. While those ones which are not prone to transformation into malignancy will not be susceptible. So any age above 26, since the natural infection has already happened in this part of the world, there is no point immunizing. While if we begin little earlier, like 11 and 12 years of age, when the infection has not yet reached the child, that is the time the immunization or the effect of immunization is going to be the best. Like in COVID, we've seen yes, can you hear me now? Am I audible? So what is staging? Staging is nothing but the degree of involvement of the cervix. So if there is carcinoma in C2, which on biopsy we say CIN3, or pap smear we say HCL, that is the stage 0. Stage 1 is when carcinoma is confined to cervix. Now stage 1A is a preclinical carcinoma that is only diagnosed by microscopy. However, the stretch of the neoplastic lesion is not really visible with the naked eye. While 1A1 is this stromal invasion, which is no deeper than 3 millimeters and not wider than 7 millimeters. Like 1A2 is the maximum depth of invasion of stroma deeper than 3 millimeters and not deeper than 5 millimeters taken from the base of the epithelium. And horizontal invasion is not more than 7 millimeters. 1B is histologically invasive carcinoma confined to cervix and greater than stage 1A2. While stage 2 is when carcinoma extends beyond the cervix but not beyond the pelvic wall. While stage 3 is when carcinoma is extended to the pelvic wall. And stage 4 when carcinoma is extended beyond the true pelvis or has involved the mucosa of bladder and rectum and also the metastatic lesions. Understood? Have you understood? Okay. So shall we call it a day, or there are more doubts? Okay, so we'll stop it now. Thank you so much.